Hi everyone, let us discuss this Fibonacci theorem. So in this theorem, we have a set E, which is a rectangle in R2, AB cross CD. In this diagram, you can easily see. So we have a function F, which is integrable on this E. Okay, let me write that thing. So we have F is integrable on E. Okay, so what we have to do, we have to prove that this double integration exists. Integration of f of xy for integration from c to d and integration from a to b. This double integration exists, this thing we have to prove. Okay, so let us start to prove it. So we are going to prove using Riemann criterion. So we are familiar with Riemann criterion. So for given epsilon greater than 0, we show that there exists a partition such that upper sum minus lower sum is less than epsilon. Okay, so let us take one epsilon first. Let epsilon greater than 0 be given. See, we have function is integrable. Okay, so here for f also we can apply Riemann criterion. So Riemann criterion says function if integrable, then there exists a partition P. Let me write. Therefore, there exists a partition P of E, of this rectangle E, such that UPF minus LPF is less than epsilon, we will call it as 1. Okay, so this is very important thing we have, since given information is F is integrable, right? See here, partition P, I will consider, let partition P will be like this, P is equal to P1 cross P2. Okay, so where, what is P1? Where P1 is a partition of closed interval AB. A is equal to x0, x1 and so on. Xn is equal to B. So that means P1 is a partition of AB. So we will have like this. So because of this partition, we will have vertical lines, right? Okay, so we'll have like this. I'm drawing a rough sketch. Okay, and P2 is equal to C is equal to y0, y1 and so on. Yk, which is equal to D. So P1 is a partition of closed interval AB and P2 is a partition of closed interval CD. So because of partition of CD, we will have horizontal lines. Okay. So because of partitions P1 and P2, this rectangle E will be divided into N into K sub rectangles. We will call them as Rij. Okay. So make a screenshot of it. After that, we will go further. Okay, so these things I mentioned on here. So we have a sub rectangles Rij. Okay, so R11, R12 in this way. See, after that, what will I do? So actually, we have to prove that that double integration exists. So I will consider the inner integral is equal to g of x. Okay, so let me mention, let g of x is equal to that inner integral. Okay, you can go back and you can see the question. So the, whatever the inner integral, that is integration c to d, f of xy dy, right? So this is the inner integral. We are considering it as g of x. Okay, so after that, what will I do? So you know that when we take a partition, we can consider capital MI, we define capital MI, small MI. So same thing I will do here also. I will define capital MIJ. Okay, so let capital MIJ, which is equal to supremum of f of xy, where xy belongs to Rij. Okay, for each sub rectangle we will have capital Mij, and small Mij is equal to, you are familiar with that, infimum of f of xy, okay, where xy belongs to Rij. Obviously these are true for all I running from 1 to n and j running from 1 to k. Okay, yes, so basic things we assume. So after that, what will I do? I will fix our x. And we can let vary y. So let me mention, now we take sum fix x belongs to xi minus 1 xi and y belongs to yj minus 1 yj be any arbitrary. See, arbitrary. So that means we fix our x for this interval, from this interval, and y belongs to this any arbitrary element. So definitely one thing we can write here, let me mention here. Okay, so then clearly our f of xy is less than or equal to capital M I j. Okay, so as you know, capital M I j means supremum of function. So that's why f of xy is obviously less than or equal to capital M I j. I should mention here, for all y belongs to y j minus 1 y j. Okay, so already we have fixed x. After that, what will I do? I will multiply both sides by yj minus 1. Okay, so that will be a positive real number. So if you multiply, inequality will be maintained. So let me do. So implies f of xy yj minus 1 less than or equal to mij yj minus yj minus 1. See, actually yj is greater than yj minus 1. So if you subtract a smaller number from larger number, you will have a positive real number. So this is a positive real number. So if you multiply both sides, inequality will be maintained. And obviously, it is true for all j running from 1 to k. So if it is true for all j, so we can take summation of both sides, j running from 1 to k. So let me write. So implies summation f of xy yj minus 1 j running from 1 to k less than or equal to summation j running from 1 to k mij yj minus yj minus 1. Okay, so this thing we have. See, there is no more space to write. Make a screenshot of it, then we will go further. See, but the given information is this integral exists. Okay, so what we have, this integral exists and this inequality is true. So if this summation is less than that summation and this integral exists, we can replace this summation by that integral. So therefore, what can we write? The integral, integration c to d f of xy dy less than or equal to summation, let me write, j running from 1 to k mij yj minus yj minus 1. Are you familiar with this integral? That is nothing but our g of x, right? So therefore, our g of x less than or equal to summation j running from 1 to k capital mij yj minus yj minus 1, right? Since we have already called it as g of x. See, after that, we can definitely say this is true for all x. Actually, it is true for all x belongs to xi minus 1 xi. I agree we have fixed our x, but that x was also arbitrary. So therefore, it is true for any x belongs to this interval. So therefore, g of x is less than this one, then its supremum is also less than same summation. So let me write, therefore, supremum of g of x where x belongs to, or simply we can write xi minus 1 less than or equal to x less than or equal to xi, that is also less than or equal to summation j running from 1 to k capital mij yj minus 1, right? So yeah, we are already familiar with that supremum. This is nothing but capital M. So let me write. So this is capital mi. Okay, so I will write a dash since we have used that symbol capital M for function f. So capital M I dash for function g. So this is less than or equal to summation j running from 1 to k capital M I j yj minus yj minus 1. Okay, let me remove this one. It is not required now. So we will have some more space to write. Okay, so I have removed. See, actually it is true for all I running from 1 to n, obviously. All I running from 1 to n, okay? So after that, what will I do? I will multiply both sides by xi minus xi minus 1. After multiplying both sides by xi minus xi minus 1, we will have this one, okay? So actually xi is greater than xi minus 1. So xi minus xi minus 1 is a positive real number. So if you multiply both sides by positive real number, same inequality will be maintained. And one more thing, that is true for all I running from 1 to n. So that's why we can take summation of both sides, okay? So let me mention. So therefore, summation I running from 1 to n mi dash xi minus 1 less than or equal to, here I running from 1 to n, already we had one summation of j, so here we have added one more summation of I. So mij, okay, xi minus 1 into yj minus 1, okay? So are you familiar with this one? This is nothing but definition of upper sum, okay? This is definition of what? Upper sum. mi dash mi. So actually mi is a supremum of g, so this is upper sum of g, getting, this is upper sum of g, and I running from 1 to n, I running from 1 to n, so this is partition with partition p1, here we had a partition p2, so this is upper sum of g with partition p1, and this is nothing but upper sum of f, upper sum of f, since you know that mij means supremum of f of xy, so this is upper sum of f with partition p, since I running from 1 to n and j running from 1 to k. So let me write that thing, after that we'll go further. So therefore we got this one, this is first, left hand side is upper sum of g with partition p1, and this is upper sum of f with partition p. A very important thing we have got, I'm calling it as 2, okay, I'm calling it as 2. So similarly, okay, similarly we can prove that, let me mention, similarly we can prove that l P1G is greater than or equal to LPF. On the same line we can prove. Here we had taken capital MI dash, capital MIJ. But if you go for the small MIJ, small MI dash, then you can prove in the same way this one. Okay. So let me call it as 3. After that, what will I do? I will multiply both sides by minus 1. So inequality will get changed. So therefore, minus LP1G less than or equal to minus LPF. By multiplying by minus 1, we got this inequality. Let me remove this one, it is not required now. Okay. See, will you guess our next step? Next step is obviously we are going to add 2 and 4. So adding, let me mention 2 and 4. What will you have? We have to add left hand side. So UP1G and this minus LP1G, right? Less than or equal to. And now I'm going to add right hand side, so UPF, right, UPF, and this minus LPF, okay. So by adding, we have got this one. But you remember the first inequality. So first inequality says this is less than epsilon. I should mention from 1. So what we get, so therefore, UP1G minus LP1G is less than epsilon. Yes, so by Riemann criterion we can say function g is integrable. Let me mention, so therefore g is integrable on closed interval ab, since actually g is a function of x. If you know g is a function of x and we take x from closed interval ab, so that's why function g is integrable on closed interval ab. That means what can we write? So therefore, integration a to b g of x dx exists, getting, g of x dx exists. But do you remember our definition of g? Definition of g was again an integral. So let me put the value of g there. So therefore, integration a to b, the value of g was integration c to d f of xy dy dx, getting. So we got this one. So we I simply put the value of g, and I should mention again that exists. That means we say the double integration exists, getting. So half part we have completed here. Actually the one target was to prove the double integration exists. After that we have to prove that double integration is equal to double integration over e f, okay, that thing also we have to prove. So after that, what will I do? I'm going to use 2 and 3. Okay, let me mention. So from 2 and 3, let us see what will you have. LPF, right? What we have less than or equal to LP1G. Okay, LP1G. We know that lower sum is always less than or equal to upper sum. So this is less than or equal to UP1G. Okay, and again from 2 we have UP1G is less than or equal to UPF. Okay, UPF. So this thing we have. Actually, it is true for, let me mention, it is true for any partition, okay, any partition P of E. This is true for any partition P of E. So that's why here we can take a supremum, there we can take a infimum. So therefore, let me mention, supremum of LPF less than or equal to LP1G less than or equal to UP1G less than or equal to infimum UPF. This is true for any partition, okay. So here we can take a supremum, there we can take a infimum. But do you know, supremum of lower sum is nothing but lower integral. So therefore LF, that means lower integral less than or equal to LPG less than LP1G less than or equal to UP1G, and infimum of upper sum is nothing but upper integral. So this is less than or equal to UF. Very important thing we have got. Okay, so there is no more space to write. Make a screenshot of it, then we will go further. See, but we know that actual integral always lies between lower sum and upper sum. So let me mention, but LP1G is less than or equal to integration, I should mention here, integration a to b g of x dx less than or equal to upper sum with partition P1G. Since actual integral always lies between upper sum and lower sum, so that's why we could write it. So see, if I put it here, what will we have? So therefore LF is less than or equal to what we have, LP1G, and we have LP1G is less than or equal to this integral. So we can write here this integral g of x dx, this integral is less than or equal to UP1G, and UP1G is less than or equal to UF. So I should write here UF. Okay, see, but the very important thing is function f is integrable on E. That is a given thing to us. Okay, so let me mention, but g is integrable on E, g is integrable on E. So therefore, you know the definition of integrable function. Upper integral is equal to lower integral is equal to actual integral. Then we say the function is integrable. So therefore, f is integrable on E. So therefore, UF is equal to LF is equal to double integration of F over E. Okay, or you can say F of XY dA. That means here, lower integral is equal to upper integral. So that's why the middle one is also equal. So therefore we can mention, so double integration over E f of xy dA is equal to this integral, integration a to b g of x dx. See, this is not required, let me remove it. Okay, but see, now we have to prove the value of g of x. So already we have defined our g of x, so let me put that value here. So therefore double integration f of xy dA over E is equal to integration a to b, okay, integration a to b, definition of g is integration c to d f of xy dy, and after that we have dx. So in this way we proved equality. That means this double integration can be calculated using this iterated integrals. Okay, so proof is over here. Make a screenshot of it, then we will stop. Thank you. Bye bye.